Morning, ladies, gents, and jerks. Now, this video is quite a bit late, but there's a reason for that. Now, as you can tell from the title, this is a delayed response to Brandon S. video and Shad's response to his video about longbows versus musket and a couple of points. Now, a while ago, I did do a video, Why Use a Musket, talking about a lot of the same stuff, and I was going to do this pretty much as soon as I saw Shad's video, and there's a problem. Now, here's my musket. You notice something missing? I sent it off to get the, because it wasn't giving me good spark. So, and finding someone that still works on these is a bit of a pain in the ass. I had to send the damn thing across the pond. And, it's been stuck in customs here in the U.S. for nearly a month. So, if I get it before the end of the year, I'll be surprised. So, just kind of pretend that it's there for now. So, what exactly am I talking about here? I need to clean that up. But... What am I talking about here specifically? Well, one thing that they brought up that irritates me is this idea that bows are harder than muskets to use. They use muskets because they're just so simple. You give a guy a week's training and he's golden. That's not true at all. And I'm also going to bring up crossbows because a lot of the same stuff applies to them. Oh, they use crossbows because they're more simple. No. Now, I'm not the most physically fit fellow around. I do some physical labor, but, you know, I'm not, you know, Harold von Hugen muscles. And this, if I recall right, 70-pound bow, right? Now, again, it's a modern compound, but I'm not the most physically fit fellow, but I can pull this thing. A medieval peasant should have no problems pulling a bow 70 to 90 pounds, which is what the war, almost all war bows, minus a few exceptions, were in the 70 to 90 pound range. The Welsh, or better known as English, they took them from the Welsh, those longbows were the exception. Yeah, you can't just pick up a 120 pound bow and use it right off the bat. You kind of need to build up to that, but, you know, a lower end war bow? Not that hard. Yeah, there are a lot of people these days that can't. Again, you're using muscles you're not really used to. But here's the thing. You can do this repeatedly. You can just... I went way off with that one, but as you can tell, I don't do a lot of archery. I need to. But even me, barely doing any archery... Not that hard. So, training some peasants into archers, yeah, you're not going to be rocking 130-pound longbows, but standard bow, easily feasible. And that's kind of the main point here. And talking about how to use one. Teaching somebody how to use a musket is kind of difficult. Bow, I've taught kids how to do it in like a minute. It really is as simple as grab arrow, put arrow on string, draw bow, release. After that, it's just a matter of, okay, you see where it landed? Okay, you need to go up more. And, you know, you give a guy 5 arrows. He can shoot 100 times. Probably more, depending on what he hits with it. If he's shooting into a tree, you're gonna break it sooner, but if you're shooting into something proper, like, you know, hay bales or something, not that hard. You can keep reusing the damn things. So you can get hundreds of shots with just a couple of arrows. And you can build up a lot of skill, build up your muscles so you can do this repeatedly. And again, 4 easy steps. Grab, knock, pull, release. And you can, again, you can see where it goes and make adjustments. Really, really simple. I've tried teaching people how to use the musket. I've taken out to the gun range, a couple of people there. It's like, hey, you want to try it? And the musket is more than just 4 steps. So, you're going to have to pretend that the lock's here. Freaking customs. But pow, you shot. Pull the half cock. Grab your cartridge. Rip. Prime, close pin, put to ground, pour, start the ball, draw a ramrod, seat the round all the way, pull the ramrod back out, and put it back where it belongs. This is a very important step, because if you leave it in, poof, you can't load anymore. You just stick it in there, oh, that'll be faster, until you march away, forget that it's there, and now you just got a big heavy stick. Return the ramrod, raise, full cock, then you can shoot. that's a complicated procedure, and if you give your each guy 5 rounds to train with, that's all he can do it. With a bow, you can keep going until you just naturally get it. But not with this. With this, 5 rounds, that's 5 goes. And in a high-stress environment, that many steps, you're probably going to forget some. And that actually happened. There's reports of it in the U.S. Civil War where the guys would forget to put a cap on the end of the gun. They'd pull. Everybody else would fire. They'd see all the smoke. They wouldn't realize they weren't one of the ones that shot. And they'd just keep doing it. Apparently, there were some instances some people had 5, 6, 7 rounds stacked in there. Kind of a problem. So, yeah, these are not simpler to use, and they're not simpler to train with. There's a lot more that can go wrong, and with powder, if it goes wrong, it can go really wrong. Like, you double load on this thing, you don't realize it, you shove another one down there. If you get it to go, that's a bomb in your face. Not fun. I don't imagine that's very fun to have an explosion going off right in your face. And one other thing to note, speaking of explosions, the pan's up here. When it goes off, it's poof, you're not getting a lot back. So that the whole crap in the Patriot, we got, like, which, as Brandon F. pointed out, the guy behind you, his lock is right where you're turning your face. So, yeah, that irritates me. But, again, this is pretty complicated. You can only get a couple of shots, but you can't even train where you're shooting, especially if you're alone, because here's what you see. Poof! And poof! Smoke! Smoke! That's all you see is smoke! You don't see where the bullet goes. Even if you couldn't, you could see the bullet. If there was no smoke, you couldn't really tell where it hit for the darn, because you can't follow it, especially if you're shooting, you know, 50, 100 yards. Kind of hard to tell where it goes. 100 yards with the bow, you can... because it's a big projectile, moving fairly slowly, relatively speaking. With this, you can't even see it. You might be able to see the impact of the dirt where it hits, but good luck if it's a bit of a wet day. If you've been raining the ground soft, you're not going to get a big clod of that. So training your aim, unless you have a spotter, or after every shot, you walk up, oh, so there. And even then, trying to shoot and readjust there sucks. Because if you pull and then you think, oh, I need to adjust my aim this much, yeah, that's a little bit easier than walking up and then da-da-da. With a self-loading rifle, like an AR, poof, oh, too low, poof. But with this, it's poof, ah, too low, da-da-da-da-da-da. Where was my hold again? And it takes a while to index this thing against your shoulder the exact way every time, get the same exact sight picture, which they didn't have a rear sight. I added this. They just had the front bit, which worked, but not quite as well. You don't get the true two-point index, so it's not quite as accurate, or at least easy to be as consistent. I can. So, yeah, a bit difficult. But you can't index a bow, right? Because, you know, the stock, you can pull it on your shoulder, you can hold it. No, you can better aim down. You grab this thing again. Not true. You can index this thing the same way every time. Because you pull it back. Now, this one, again, is a compound bow. If I could figure out where the crap I put in my PVC bow. Right there. I'll just get it right quick. Since it doesn't have the cams and all that, it's just a fancy little stick. So. Alright, yep. Oop, falling over. So, indexing. Not that hard. Just pull to the same spot, index to your chin. Again, not that difficult. You can actually get pretty reliable with this. So, indexing isn't really the problem. It isn't really that much of an advantage. Yeah, the stock helps, but not as much as you might think. So, again, simplicity isn't really the advantage. And... bow fell over. Now, another thing, the strength. Well, again, if you've got proper, you know, lower mid-end war bow, you can build up pretty quickly. 70 pounds isn't that much for a physically fit adult, or at least a physically active adult male. So, being able to use that, not really a problem. So, again, training. If you're building up to the very top end, yeah, okay. But teaching, just taking a peasant, giving him an average run-of-the-mill bow and saying, here's 5 arrows, get good while we're marching, and here's a lot of arrows when we get to battle. Again, you're going to have more luck with the peasant with the bow, because it's just grab, knock, pull, release. Whereas with that, it's a complicated mess. Crossbows, though. I heard that they used crossbows because they were simpler, and you didn't need to pull that much weight. No. You've never messed with a crossbow. Now, I've not messed with a medieval one properly, but I at least understand how they work. One crossbow I've got is this little dinky bastard. But it'll work for the point. There are a lot of different types of crossbow. One of the cheaper and easier ones, and weaker, was the handspan, which this one, not that hard. But the proper ones, there's a lot of struggle in there. They had this foot stirrup. So you could put it down on the ground, put your foot there, then you grab the string and yank back. Will it lock? Hey, I can lock it manually. Neat. I don't need this. Never done that before and don't really use this much, but you pull it back by hand, which crossbows tend to be a lot heavier than bows in terms of raw weight. But you're using muscle groups differently. You're using more of your body with a crossbow, especially if you got the belt hook, which hooks on the string, and you just stand up, and it uses all of your muscles to do it. There's also mechanical assistance, like the goat's foot lever, which, of course, I don't have, because I don't have a proper freaking crossbow. So there are mechanical ways, but, yeah, again, takes a lot of effort, different muscle groups, but still a lot of weight. And when you get to the really heavy ones, then you've got some complicated mechanisms, such as the crannequin or the windlass, which, with the windlass, you put it down, then you get your device out, clip it onto the back, hook it with there, and then you get your little winch, and you go, you can make the sound effects if you want, but probably I would. Wind it up, which can take a while, and doing this a lot for, you know, it takes a while to get that thing going, because you're not just rotating air, you're rotating against a hell of a spring. So you finally get that thing wound up, then you gotta hook it, unwind it a bit, then you can just pull it loose. And then you're ready to twang, then put it back. That's exhausting, and that's a lot of work, and a lot more than a bow. And the crannequin, it's this way, instead of like this, it's crank you. So, crossbows are not that easy. They aren't that easy. And again, you can say, oh, but you index the thing. Can I use it? Haha. Fake stock. Now, yeah, you can index it and hold it like this, aim it like a gun, so it's more accurate. Again, not really. You can index with a bow, but with a crossbow, the real advantage is you can hold it. Let me put it up. I could hold this position for a while, but, you know, even my 30-pound bow, after a while, gets a bit exhausting, but with this I can just, there he is, twang, missed. So, yeah, the crossbows, their advantage was you could keep it ready, and when the opportunity presented, then you could take your shot, and you can kind of use it while prone and behind cover a lot easier than a bow. Possible with the bow, as Shad showed, but not quite as easy, not quite as complete. And you can, with the pavise shield, you can hide behind that a lot better than with the bow. There's a fair amount of advantages, but once you get the musket, with power, with the range, the penetration, the noise, and smoke, you can factor in the psychological effect of eating a volley that you can't see. All of a sudden, boom! And you look around, who's not dead? So, yeah, that's a lot more. Again, arrows, that break up your formation. Like, oh shit, what's wrong with it? But it's just boom! Whoo, not me! So, yeah, that's a lot scarier. Again, smoke and the thunder, and the range, the power, there's so many advantages to that. And compared to a crossbow, speed. Yes, speed. Again, if you've got a crannikin or a windlass, something that can compete with a higher end bows, even a goat's foot, that can take a while. Again, with the crannikin, ha-da-da-da, I just like making the sound effects. But yeah, it takes a long while. Musket, yeah, it's complicated, but it doesn't take as long as you might think. On parade, you can do 3 to 4 shots, which is a lot less than a bow, which can be 12 per minute. I forget what I did a rate of fire test. I don't remember what I pulled from that thing. But, yeah, you could get more rounds out of the bow, yes. And this would be, maybe not this specific one, but a full power crossbow would be way behind both. So, yeah, these were used mainly because you could hold it and the oomph behind the shorter, heavier bolt as it hit at closer range, pretty gnarly. And, yeah, sure, you didn't need... But, still a lot of work. So, anyways, to the main point, which was about training, bows are way simpler. Crossbows are a bit more complicated. Muskets, way more complicated. And you can keep using arrows, you can't keep using your cartridges, so 5 shots means 5 shots versus 100 shots. So in terms of training, minus, you know, the really heavy ones, bows are way simpler. And that's the main point I was trying to get across in this ramble. So, anyways, tally stinking home.